Now, who remembers this?
At Europe's biggest shopping centre, a special church service. A reminder that the shops may be open legally for the first time on a Sunday, but it's still the Sabbath. The Metro Centre in Gateshead, owned by the church commissioners. Having resisted for so long, it's now bowed to the inevitable. And an estimated 90,000 took advantage of today's opening.
Brilliant, because I work full-time, so if you work full-time, it's ideal.
Often I work Saturday, Sunday's fine for me. It's the only day sometimes I get off.
Happy memories. That was the last big deregulation of Sunday trading back in 1994. And now the government looks set to revive plans to allow local authorities in England and Wales to extend Sunday opening hours for supermarkets and major stores. At present, they're restricted to just 6 hours, a restriction that doesn't apply to smaller convenience stores. Well, it's expected to come to a Commons vote this Wednesday. But not all Conservative MPs are happy, and it looks like the position of the Scottish National Party may be crucial. Well, we're joined now by David Burrows. He's a Conservative opponent of the plan, and by the SNP, Stuart Hosey. Welcome to both of you. David Burrows, do you have enough Conservative MPs on your side to defeat the government?
We may well have. I'm concerned about our side. You can ask the SNP about their side.
I'm certainly willing
to get involved in an unholy alliance for measure that wasn't that wasn't in the Conservative manifesto. Indeed, the Prime Minister last April said there was a good, great British compromise. If you want to shop, you can shop. If you want to work, you can shop. But also, if you want to retain that special characteristic, which we still just about have in Britain, we can keep that.
How many MPs do you think you have got on your side in your party?
Well, we've got 24 signed up to the Delete Amendment. There's a number of others. I won't reveal the exact numbers here on air, but we've got a number of others who are also lined up, as well as ministers and PPSs and the like, up and down the ranks of the party.
Right.
Frankly, there's other things that we should be doing to support enterprise and small businesses. This is something which has come up from a bunch of loud voices, maybe in the West End, Harrods and Knightsbridge. They want that the tourists to be able to shop to the drop. But frankly, let's not have a domino effect on the rest of the country that will impact, not least on shop workers. And the SNP need to ask themselves a question, whether they want to put at risk what is in many ways a $74 million question, which is the cost of, on the pay packets of Scottish workers that will be put at risk, whether it's south or north of the border, there'll be a dilution of workers' rights and their pay.
Yes, you've changed your position, because actually I spoke to one of your colleagues not that long ago and you were going to be supporting David Burrows' position on this.
Well, we'll take a decision at the group meeting on Tuesday evening, in good time for the amendment debate on Wednesday. We were very clear all the way through. We've had Sunday trading in Scotland for 20 years. Mm. By and large, it's been beneficial. But also, the large businesses in Scotland, by and large, pay a premium for Sunday working. So our specific concern, very specific concern, is that if this, in essence, becomes a UK-wide system, does it have the potential, as many believe it would do, to erode premium pay on a Sunday for workers in Scotland.
So have you got a concession from the government?
No, because the whole point about this is the premium pay is not in legislation. It's done on the basis of the goodwill of businesses.
Right.
Were it in statute, in a sense it would be a far easier debate. We'd be arguing for one amendment or another, but it isn't. And therein lies the difficulty.
So what's stopping you making up your mind?
Well, we're still getting representations from both sides. Some people saying this would be an economic boon. Others, like the Keep Sunday Special campaign, saying Keep Sunday Special. And others saying...
You've got your unions, Usdaw. And others,
quite
rightly,
including Usdaw, saying this could have a detrimental effect on pay packets in Scotland. And that, perfectly understandably, has to be our primary concern.
You need the SNP, really, and that would mean you would defeat the government. So what are you talking about?
Well, we'd certainly comfortably defeat the government with the SNP. And it's looking at the evidence. I mean, whether you look at the Edinburgh Economics today, who are coming out and saying this is going to hit the pay packet of Scottish workers, or indeed the evidence on the high street that, I mean, my small businesses and Douglas's in Frinton and elsewhere, they haven't been saying, we want you to help a high street to go and make sure that the big stores are open for more than 6 hours. It's not something that's really needed.
Is it strong? Is there strong feeling in your constituency on this?
I'm a huge fan of David's, and it pains me to be on the different side of the argument to him. But look, I go to church on Sundays, and I also love shopping on Sundays, and I think we should be able to do both.
You can do both.
You have these restrictions. Why not just allow people to make these decisions for themselves? Look, technology means you can go online and buy what you want when you want. Technology with drones and driverless cars means it'll be delivered when you want.
Sure.
Why force shops?
Well, because of the issue of work. workers, of course, and whether or not it's really necessary to shop another few hours in a day.
Let other people decide that for themselves.
What say you?
Workers can't decide that for themselves, can they? They're often pressurised into working on a Sunday. When I was working in British Home Stores, we used to get double time for working on a Sunday. It's great that a third of workers in Scotland get that, but for the rest of the rest of England and Wales, that doesn't happen. And I've been sitting on the Bill Committee on this. I've signed your amendment, David. And I think the current plans strike a balance, and I think we should be keeping the rules as they are, and it means that people can shop, people can stay at home and have time with their families. And the evidence is that men who work on a Sunday spend less time reading with their families, doing leisure activities with their families. And this is worrying in terms of how families and the pressure that families are under.
Politicians know how best to spend your free time.
In terms of ministers, though, yes. I mean, you mentioned ministers in your ranks. Are you expecting resignations over this, then?
Well, I think over the weekend there's been at least one that's saying they're wrestling with their conscience because they didn't see this coming. And, you know, you heard in your clip that the previous debate, so we had 2 years to debate this. We're going to probably have 2 hours on Wednesday.
If you're lucky.
If you're lucky. And this is it. I mean, we don't just want to listen to Douglas, I admire him, and not just the voice of big business.
You might be able to persuade me, not just the voice. I have to say,
You might be able to persuade me.
With great respect, I'm doubtful.
Let me come back to Stuart Hosey. I mean, could you do a deal here with David Burrows on this issue?
It's not about doing a deal with David or a deal with anyone else. It's about looking at the evidence from both sides, weighing up the protections such as they are, what's in statute, what's not, and saying, if this goes ahead, on the balance of probability, will Scottish workers have their pay eroded or will they not? And right now, you know, we've got to be on the side of workers. It's as simple as that.
Right. So at the moment, that's your position,
Right.
Because the evidence is there. So you would be doing a deal. Well, that won't be a good look for your supporters, will it?
It's not a good look to be enabling the government to get through a deeply unpopular measure north and south of the border.
You said that without moving your lips, Stuart Hosey. What was it?
Can I just say, look, if we take this at face value, if a UK-wide system, if it ended up being that, led to the erosion of terms and conditions and pay packets in Scotland, we couldn't support that. And because the pay
you
protection...
You don't know that, though, do you, as such?
No, but because the pay protection isn't in statute, it's incredibly difficult to argue the other side of the case. Yes, we can get guarantees from some businesses, but other businesses have said to me, because this will be deployed, perhaps on an English local authority basis, it's almost undeliverable full stop.
Right.
Yeah, and that then makes it chaotic.
But isn't that the case, that it would be local authorities in the end that would make the decision, wouldn't it?
Yes, it's a one-way valve. In terms of localism, you can only further deregulate, you can't restrict.
Right. Well, what's wrong with that? I mean, if it's up to local authorities, why should politicians in Westminster, as Douglas Carson, say dictate?
But this is based on the government are making the case, without publishing all the analysis and all the evidence, they're making the case that they are in the interest of deregulation because they think it makes economic sense. That case isn't probably made, but on a local level, you'll inevitably see a competitive environment. Mm. It'll be just a race to the bottom. Each local council will have to be, because the voice of big business will be heard loud and clear, will think that they will want to deregulate further.
Is that a glass half empty sort of analysis of this?
Just remember, we're talking about using the law of the land to prevent people from spending their Sundays the way they want. Come on, we live in a free country, let people do what they want.
David Burrows.
Well, you've got to look at the people, include a lot of people, they include people shopping, and there's a lot of time for them to shop if they want to. There's also workers who you see that most of them are having to work on Sundays already. Most of them do not want to work the extra hours and do not want to feel how the implied or explicit pressure that they're going to have to work further. And that they're there for the people, families who want the choice as well. We've got a decent British compromise. Why do we need to unpick it now? It's unnecessary. Most Conservatives think, why are we doing this?
Have you got the ear of government? Are you talking to anyone? Is anyone listening to you?
I think the government have to look seriously. They're looking at different compromises. One option is to just zone into a tourist area to allow the West End shops to be able to shop till they drop. But, I mean, many are concerned by the principle as well.
Right. Well, you're saying that might be possible.
That would be an interesting idea if the West End of London, big stores, big tourist magnates said, can we do a deal in Westminster City Council or wherever the West End is in London? That's an interesting experiment. If it worked, it might be something to look at.
But the way the legislation... I've sat on the Bill Committee for this, so I have actually sat through hours in committee. The way the legislation is drafted, it's national legislation. It's not West End legislation. And Brandon Lewis's compromise about this red line around the high street, whatever that is, out of town. Well, in Wakefield, I have 5,000 people who work in retail. What does it mean? If you're outside, you don't get it. And if you do, you can't. It's confusion. And it's confusing also for the large stores. Sainsbury's, Tesco's, Waitrose have all come out and said they don't want this, because they don't want in Wakefield to have one system and in Leeds up the road another system.
Are you confident of a compromise then ahead of Wednesday?
No, not necessarily. We'll have to wait and see what happens today. What I'm confident about is that many, increasing number of my colleagues, as well as hopefully others as well, recognise this is unnecessary, it's not needed. Let's just keep things as they are. We've got a good British compromise, and then let's carry on and get on with important other issues of helping small businesses and enterprise.
Stuart Hosey, David Burrows, thank you.
Thank you.